America's public enemy number one in the United States is drug abuse. In order to fight and defeat this enemy, it is necessary to wage a new all-out offensive. Fundamentally, it is essential for the American people to be alerted to this danger, to recognize that it is a danger that will not pass with the passing of the war in Vietnam, which has brought to our attention the fact that a number of young Americans have become addicts as they serve abroad, whether in Vietnam or Europe or other places.
But it's straight. In other words, you're just going to give a sort of a cross-section of opinion? Is there an overlay of a commentary?
No, I don't think so yet. Right, we haven't. All we've done is make things.
That's the one that changes the whole.
What we're trying to do is avoid that by just putting it together. Everything from police chiefs to just street freaks.
Right, that's
and without their position. And hopefully, listening to it, anyone will have to make up their own mind anyway, but they'll have a wide basis of opinions to choose from.
That's cool.
And no one will actually be identified as a police chief or as a dope thief or as whatever their position is. The authority, whatever authority they have, will mean what they say and how they say it.
The casting's very good.
It's very
good. Central casting is really good in there. Character actors they send over for the parts. All I got to figure out is what part I'm supposed to play. Because we do have a serious drug problem in this community. Or, it's all cool, baby.
Yeah.
It's just the way it is, man. That's the way it's going down. Okay. I'm ready to be interviewed.
There's a lot of things about drugs that people don't know. There's a lot of things that I don't know. And like here I am, I'm working with drug problems all the time. And I guess the most thing is ignorance. And I really can't see how this record you're cutting is going to really do much about that. But, you know, when you talk about drugs to older people, it's immediate paranoia. And immediate, you know, you don't know what you're talking about. And these people are basing their information on the leading sources in the whole entire world, Reader's Digest and Ladies' Home Journal.
And the thing that I do with my children, I probably have a little negative approach, too. They get the negative treatment. I don't tell them any lies, but I tell them the truth, but probably on the negative side. Well, of course, I drink alcohol and I smoke cigarettes, but it's because that nobody ever told me it wasn't the right thing to do. I wish I never did, you know. But that happens to be a habit. But if I had, if I knew now, I wouldn't have done it. And they say like cigarettes, they're not physically addictive, but yet they're psychologically addictive, and they're hard to quit because you do
natural, not the artificial kind. That's why Salem tastes springtime soft, springtime fresh. It's only natural.
I'm not condemning your smoking an occasional marijuana cigarette because you understand about life.
But the only way you can find out about it is by experiment.
Not if you've already wrecked yourself by the time you're in the eighth grade. You can't ever find out about it.
So after about 3 or 4 years of trying every way I knew how to stay high, in taking larger and larger doses, more and more, as many different kinds of drugs, you know, starting with pot to smooth the onset, then acid, strong amount of acid, and then maybe a little cocaine to make it a little clearer as you started, and then a little this and a little that, and, you know, everything to make it just, I mean, you become an alchemical wizard, you know, in your own nervous system. I began to realize finally that we didn't know enough chemically. We didn't know enough to work with whatever these were to be able to maintain our state of expanded awareness, which these were clearly connected with. There wasn't any doubt.
I don't know. I can't tell anybody they shouldn't take it or anything.
I would like to suggest that you do not use speed. And here's why. It's going to mess up your heart, mess up your liver, your kidneys, rot out your mind. In general, this drug will make you just like your mother and father.
Well, after developing people's senses of themselves, they still end up using drugs. We cannot set up our moral standards. Set up our moral standards to say, you know, this person should be condemned.
Right? Not if you've already wrecked yourself by the time you're in the eighth grade. You can't ever find out about it.
That's his personal choice, as long as he's not messing his body up or something else. We might personally want to get that person not dependent upon the drugs. But if he is using those drugs, and we know it, I mean, that shouldn't affect our sense of that other person.
Do drugs because they can't get it on with a chick. As many different people, there's a different reason, a different variation.
And there's many different reasons there are. There's probably that many different drugs.
Like, there's no just one reason people do drugs. Most people don't even realize. Most people don't bother to think about the fact that they are doing drugs. They just do them.
And I would be willing to bet in 5 years we look back at the late 60s and early 70s as being that peculiar time when everyone thought the drugs were either enlightenment or escape.
Ticket to ride. Just a matter of time now till I'll be up in the sky. Coming up on me now, I can go and ride. What's it gonna be?
Drugs do one of two things. They either stimulate or depress.
Perhaps that's too simple a model in terms of, like, understanding.
It is a very simplistic model, yes, but look at the other simplistic models that abound. Drugs are the work of the devil, at the most basic. Drugs are part of the communist conspiracy, or drugs are terrible things which will kill you, or drugs are things which people use to escape, or drugs are this, or drugs are that. Hell, drugs are chemicals.
When you feel one of those headaches building, Anacin has what it takes to relieve headache pain and its tension.
You can't get a stronger cough formula than Romalar without a prescription.
They're all together now.
All the refreshment of menthol, all the good things I forget, it's all together.
And these range from caffeine and nicotine through the various other stimulants which you need a prescription for. They include alcohol,
they include marijuana,
other hallucinogens,
stimulants which you need
they
include barbiturates,
they include alcohol,
they include marijuana,
they include glue, which many young kids have a habit of sniffing,
gasoline,
tranquilizers,
solvents,
depressants,
they include glued,
which
the various narcotics,
young kids
such as morphine,
have a habit
heroin,
of sniffing, gasoline, Demerol, and other similar
and so
solvents, and they include
now, these are
the various narcotics,
so-called
such as morphine,
mind drugs,
heroin,
Demerol, they're
called that because
so
they're
forth.
Taken usually for their effect.
Now these
on
are
the
commonest
so-called mind drugs. They're called that because they're taken usually for their effect on the psyche. They're called that because they're taken usually for their effect on the psyche. They either pick you up or they put you down. And sometimes they do very strange things to your head.
What do you think drugs are? I don't know for people, I don't know. You know they've been doing drugs ever since there's been straight. You know, ever since there's been man, as far as I know, I'm taking it way back to early Indian trips.
Not as many people been doing as many drugs.
That's because there's more people now than there have been. That's the way I'd answer.
Or slogans which really are meaningful in dealing with the problems that we have before us. What we can begin to do is to begin to say, all right, we have a specific problem in a specific area, and let's find out what that problem is and what kinds of resources need to be brought to bear upon a given manifestation of that problem in society.
I say that the problem should be attacked from the assumption that the people is the problem, not the drug. Drugs are good, they have good purposes medicinally, and they're not supposed to be abused, and that's the problem. And go further than that, the people evidently have a need to abuse the drug. They have a need to kill themselves and shoot dirty needles in their arm and get venereal diseases and hepatitis and go to jail.
You can go back to about when Timothy Leary started to experiment with LSD and get widespread publicity. Then the young college kids
Cuenavaca,
and the high school
Mexico,
kids started to take up experimenting.
Comment, I learned more in those 9 hours than I had learned in my whole life as a psychologist and so on about the man's mind and about the human potential.
In my estimation, the conclusion of the drug syndrome, which is probably going to take another 15 to 20 years to even to reach a threshold or a level that can be worked with in any intelligent manner, will be, in my estimation, or the way I see it, will be brought about by social changes and also by not so much drug education in schools, but by observation. And what I mean by this is that these addictive personalities begin to show probably the first place that you bring kids together, and that's in school, kindergarten, first and second grades. And I think that most of the kids who are going to be addictive personalities, who are going to be sociopathic, and who are going to be the criminals and the misfits of society in a later year, will indicate it there. And these addictive personalities start to show out when a kid is 5 or 6 years old. By
I've been a musician all my life, see? I'm 23 years old. I've been playing 5 and 7 nights a week since I was 13 years old. So I started playing in the clubs and going to school, doing my homework on breaks, you know. Guy comes up to me one day, one night when I was playing. Told me I looked pretty tired. It sounds like the way they do it in the movies. This is the way that can happen. So he comes up to me. Actually, he was a kind of a kid, yeah. Yeah, he was a kid about 18. He was a guy to me. He told me I looked tired, asked me if I wanted something to keep me awake, you know? And I said, sure. You know, I was really dead. 5 nights a week and going to school, man, you know? 3 or 4 hours sleep. So I experienced my first amphetamine high.
In order to deal effectively with the problem, we should have at least 2 persons in the schoolroom. One is an observer and one is an educator. To see and to spot these addictive personalities and to start dealing with the kid at that age, not to wait until they get into high school, because the people...
Well, in the high school, everyone's got enough sense in their head to, you know, like they, like freshman year, that's the year that you just get into it.
Yeah.
Because it's the cool thing to do. and then you realize that it isn't really, you know, and then sometimes you'll do it just because you want to. You feel like getting high, so you'll get high.
So the addictive personality is one who's acting in a sociopathic manner, one who is not conforming, at least to some degree, and one who is just acting like a lunatic, one who acts, you know, like he's bored or depressed or frustrated, from one end of the spectrum to the other, introversion or extroversion. And these are addictive personalities. The majority of the kids today are not addictive personalities. They're like somebody said, they're damn fools.
And plus, it was non-addictive, those, remember, amphetamines? Non-addictive drug. So groovy, you know? So I like the experience. And I started off taking a little green Benzedrine. I don't even know the dosage, but the prescription's prescribed three times a day, you know? One every other Friday night, you know, because I was scared. And, like, this went on for a year. You know, that's how long, you know, I was very, very careful. And then eventually, well, Saturday night was pretty rough, you know, but I was still frightened. So I just took it, it just took time, about a year. Then I got the balls, I took one Saturday night, okay? Okay, Friday and Saturday, groovy, that went on for such and such a time. I don't know how long. And then Sunday was my day of hell. Speed at one, it had done its job, but it's
like... Somebody said they're damn fools, that's all. They're playing a dangerous game. Just for lack of something else to do, they're experimenting with drugs. We have space-age technology, and we have a 1942 recreation set up. We haven't kept up with it. These kids, to them, this is recreation. See, this is their idea of space-age recreation, to stay in line with the space age technology and progress that we've reached. Their idea of space age recreation is to trip, to get high, and to get stoned, because they haven't got a goddamn thing else to do.
I guess I turned on about maybe 5 years ago for the first time. And since then I've smoked grass sort of regularly, but sometimes more than others.
Because the people with the addictive personalities who are using drugs and who have started to act out their whatever's destined for them, it's too late. The only thing you can hope is that they don't kill themselves.
Then I took this chemical, and I sat later alone in Tim's living room, and I suddenly saw a being about 8 feet away from me across the room, and... when I strained in the darkness to see who it was, I saw that it was myself, and that I was in a cap and gown. And it was for a middle-class boy from Boston who had become a professor and a PhD. To see your professorness standing across the room is kind of anxiety-provoking, since you worked so hard to get it. And there was a little flip of anxiety, but I figured, well, if that's what this drug means, I've got to give that one up because it's too dishonest. Okay, that's cool. The minute I said that, it changed, and I looked again, and now it was me as pilot, and then me as cellist, and then me as lover, and then me as in each of my social roles. And each one I'd say, okay, that's cool, let that one go, and that would go. And then finally, I saw Richard Alpertness, which was like the core concept of my personality, sitting over there. And that got me uptight, because that was like the guy behind all the other roles. And I thought, well, if that goes, I'll have amnesia. You know, that's what Tim's done to me. He's given me this wild drug, I'll have amnesia. Okay, so I'll have amnesia. And I gave that one up. And I thought, well, at least I have my body. And then, of course, I looked down, and I couldn't see anything below my kneecaps. And then, to my horror, the whole body disappeared, till I was looking down, and I was looking directly at the couch I was sitting on, but I was looking right through my body, and there was the couch. There was no body. Now, if you can put yourself in the position of somebody who's had the training I've had, up until then, I can say, gee, that's an interesting hallucination. But at the point where your eyes are open and you're looking at where your body should be and it isn't, your basis of informational input has been destroyed, and there's quite a bit of panic. And I thought I was going to die. That was what usually would be called a bad trip, or a bummer in these days, I guess. And I thought, I'm going to die. and I was about to scream. The adrenaline was pumping through me, and I was going to scream for help. And just then, this little tiny voice inside me said, "Who's mining the store?" Like, who's about to scream? Who's dying? You see, there was somebody in here noting the whole thing, although he wasn't my personality, and he wasn't my body, and he wasn't any of my social role. And it was as if I had just met for the first time who I am, which was clearly behind all that stuff. It was like just a point of awareness. It was consciousness. It was whatever you want to call it, lots of labels, none of which do justice. And suddenly, a great peace descended on me, and a great feeling of calmness and harmony and in-tuneness. And it was as if I had touched an eternal place that was nothing that had to do with life and death.
These kids, to them, this is recreation.